Hi, I am Professor Tian. I am a macroeconomist.
In this short video, we will cover aggregate demand. We will go over the definition of aggregate demand, how to derive this relationship, and the exogenous factors that will change aggregate demand and shift the aggregate demand curve. Economists define the aggregate demand relationship as the quantity of all goods and services demanded at any given price level. So aggregate demand, or AD for short, is a relationship between Y, the quantity of all goods and services, and P, the price level. To graphically illustrate the aggregate demand, we need to have output Y on the horizontal axis and price P on the vertical axis. The negative slope of the aggregate demand curve tells us that there is a negative correlation between the two variables, meaning that as the general price level declines, the economy's demand for goods and services increases. Is this relationship intuitive? Let's consider the demand of a single good first, say a chocolate bar. If a chocolate bar becomes cheaper, would you want more of it? I certainly would. Hence, when the price goes down, demand goes up. The negative relationship between price and quantity demanded should feel intuitive. But we have to consider the entire economy's goods and services now, rather than just a single good. So a more systematic way to derive this negative correlation between P and Y is to make use of the income identity equation, Y equals to C plus I plus G plus NX. Let's see how prices influences each of the four components of output Y. Then we can add them up to find the aggregate impact of prices on output. Let's start with consumption. P's impact on C works through what economists refer to as the wealth effect. Let's suppose prices decline. When prices go down, what happens to the value of money? Can you buy more or less stuff with the same dollar? Things are cheaper when prices go down, so you should be able to buy more. The value of money increases as a result. Lower prices, therefore, make you wealthier in real terms, so you will consume more as a result, and C increases. When C goes up, as you can see from the income identity equation before, so does Y. Therefore, the correlation between P and Y through consumption C is negative. As P declines, real wealth increases, C increases, and Y increases. Next, let's try to do the same kind of analysis with the next component of income, investment I. P's impact on I works through what economists refer to as the interest rate effect. Let's suppose prices decline, like before. As we just discussed, because prices are lower, if you want to maintain the same level of consumption, you need fewer dollars to do so. What should we do with leftover cash? Just hold on to it? Holding on to cash when you don't spend it is a bit of a waste, since cash earns no interest. If I now need less cash to purchase the same amount of stuff as before, then the leftover cash I can put it to better use by purchasing something, let's say government bonds, that can get me some positive rate of return. If there are a lot of people who think the same way, what do you think would happen to the demand for these government bonds? It would increase, of course. And if demand for bonds increase, what do you think happens to the interest rate that the bonds pay? Because demand for these interest-bearing assets is high, the firms or governments that issue these bonds don't have to offer high interest rates to entice savers to buy their bonds. Hence, as demand for bonds increase, interest rate falls. Firms or governments that issue bonds do so in order to finance their investments. Firms may issue bonds to finance the building of a new plant. Governments may issue bonds to finance building more schools to educate its citizens. When interest rate falls, it is cheaper for firms and governments to issue bonds and borrow. So they would borrow more and invest more, which leads to increases in investment I. From the income identity equation, if I goes up, so does Y. Therefore, the correlation between P and Y through investment I is negative. As P declines, demand for bonds increases, interest rate decreases, investment I increases, and output Y increases. The next component of income is government expenditure, G. Typically, in simple macro models, we treat G as exogenous, meaning that we assume the government decides on a value for G and their decision is not related to other macro variables like prices. So this makes our analysis very easy. There is no relationship between P and G. As P declines, there is no change in government expenditure G. The last component of output we will talk about is net export, NX. The way P affects net export is through its impact on the real exchange rate. Economists call this the exchange rate effect. Recall our definition for the real exchange rate, Q equals to EP divided by P star. This means that if domestic prices go down, holding E and P star constant, Q goes down as well. A decrease in Q is a real exchange rate depreciation, meaning a unit of domestic good is worth less foreign goods now. On the surface, that might sound like bad news for the domestic economy. But the flip side is that if we're trying to sell our products to foreigners, because of the real depreciation, our products are now cheaper relative to foreign goods. And this makes them more attractive to foreigners, and we sell more of our products. Exports increases as a result. Also, because foreign goods are now relatively more expensive, we demand less and buy less from foreigners, making imports decline. Recall that NX is exports minus imports. So the combination of an increase in exports and a decline in imports mean that NX increases. According to the income identity equation, if net export NX increases, output Y increases. Therefore, the correlation between P and Y through NX is again negative. As P declines, real exchange rate depreciates, exports increase, imports decrease, NX increases, and output increases. So all of the components of GDP that we looked at suggest a negative correlation between P and Y. When we sum up the components to produce output demanded, we will maintain that negative correlation. Now, let's talk about graphing 101. Any variable on the axes of a graphical model are called endogenous variables. So when either P or Y changes, we are moving from one point of the curve to another, moving along the curve does not shift. But if an economic event changes any of the components of GDP, and the cause of that event is not a price change or an output change, then it is considered an exogenous event that will shift the aggregate demand curve. Whether we have a movement along the curve or a shift of the curve is something that trips up a lot of students. So the easiest way to figure out whether a shift in aggregate demand is required is to determine if the economic event changes aggregate demand via a change in the endogenous variables, P or Y, or via an exogenous variable. For example, suppose the stock market rallies because investors are feeling optimistic. Anyone who owns stocks would now be wealthier, even if the profits are not realized. Given the newfound wealth, investors will want to consume more, and that increases output Y. Note here that the increase in consumption, and therefore output, is due to an increase in wealth from rising stock value, not a change in price. Since stock value is an exogenous variable, it is not on the axis of a graphical model. This economic event will shift the aggregate demand curve. Which way would aggregate demand curve shift in this example? For any given price level, people consume more because of rising stock value. So C is higher and Y is higher at every level of P. This must be an outward shift of aggregate demand. Many different types of economic events can shift the aggregate demand curve. Your textbook has a long list of examples, different exogenous shocks that impact C, I, G, or NX can all shift the aggregate demand curve. Just remember that any exogenous change that increases output at any given price level shifts the aggregate demand curve out or towards the right. Any exogenous change that decreases output at any given price level shifts the aggregate demand in or towards the left. To sum up, we learned that aggregate demand slopes downward because of the wealth effect, the interest rate effect, and the exchange rate effect. We also learned that aggregate demand will shift in if an exogenous economic event impacts the components of GDP.
To sum up, we have learned that aggregate demand slopes downward because of the wealth effect, the interest rate effect, and the exchange rate effect. We also learned that aggregate demand will shift if an exogenous economic event impacts one of the components of GDP. I hope this quick overview of aggregate demand has helped you achieve a better understanding of the relationship between prices and the quantity demanded.